Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Our meeting will now come to order, and let us bow for invocation, please. Our Father, we thank you for all our many blessings. We thank you for this opportunity to serve Alamance County. I pray that you will bless this board and give us the wisdom and discernment to make sound and impartial decisions and work together for the common good of Alamance County. We pray for all our county and city leaders and the leaders of our country, Lord, that they will guide us in the same manner as we face this great economic struggle. Lord, let us never forget the freedom that we enjoy in this country and keep our soldiers safe as they continue to fight for this freedom. Amen. Okay. Next, I'll start with the public comments. Eric Richardson, we want to remind you that you have 3 minutes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Chairman Massey.
Yes,
Commissioners.
Sir.
I've appeared before y'all a number of times, and I've never identified why I come. I'm a master's candidate in American history at North Carolina Central, and I've completed a quarter to a third of my doctoral work in Native American history at Chapel Hill and Duke. I go to Richmond every year to bring money back to Alamance County. So I work up there and come back here. Tuesday, 2 weeks ago, I woke up and turned on the news, and on the lead news for Richmond News was Alamance County and the commissioner's decision to support Arizona. Now, my friends all know that I live in Alamance County, and my area of specialization in history is the development of Southern racism. And they came to me on Tuesday and said, what in the world is your county thinking about? Well, it's an election year, and it has a lot to do with the election. And that assuaged a small bit of the problem. And they said, well, what's the unemployment rate in the county? So, well, we reported it 12.5%, which is an effective 30%. If the government were being honest with us, there's about 30% chronic unemployment, long-term unemployment. And they said, do they really think that people are going to come locate businesses here with that kind of position? I look at this from a law of unintended consequence. That's what a historian does. Politicians make decisions. It appears as though in the short term it makes a whole lot of sense. In the long term, it makes almost no sense whatsoever, because the way the media is covering this is that it's not against illegal immigrants. The caption across the bottom of the screen said, Alamance County opposes immigrants, which we've never done as a country. We are all the descendants of immigrants. We didn't have papers when we came here, and I have as much frustration with the federal government as the next man. I think the federal government should take a position on this, and they're not going to. They are issuing documents that allow people to pay Social Security who are not citizens of this country. But for us as a county to make that decision, that's not good. And we join with New Hanover County and Cleveland County as one of 3 counties in this state. And trust me when I said Richmond put us in this boat with Wilmington. And I said to my friends in Virginia, this is not what you think. This is the appearance on the surface is different. I know every one of my commissioners. I know my commissioners. I have appeared before this commission a number of times. This is not the way these people are. They said, but this is what it appears. So I just wanted to come and say, sometimes when political decisions are made by the commission, they have negative impact beyond the borders of our county.
Thank you. Okay,
Ed, I said that before they done it, didn't stop me. Good evening, Madam Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I want to speak against, at least try to slow you down on this towing the car talk. It can be proved to me that you can do it and not spend a dollar to save a dime. Expanded, you know, government expansion and government intrusion. Maybe. But I don't think we're going to come out on it. But if you're going to do it anyway, just to show you there's other options, has anybody considered the viability of a booth to keep these auto people from making money on it? In other words, these garages or whatever's going to be doing it. You can buy a booth functional for this purpose for less than $200. You can actually buy them for less than $100 that would probably do this. Because you know who's got the boot, and you're not dragging people's car off. So if they go out there, you get a relatively cheap boot and put on the car, and they tear it up, you know who you're going to be hitting with the fine and paying for the boot and whatnot. Plus, it looks like to me there would be some way the county could recoup a little more money using that method instead of so-and-so's garage making all the money. And the county putting out the deputy with two trips, blah, blah, at least two. If it's in my case, I'm going to park my car over in Orange County, and you're going to have to go through them, and I'm going to tie everybody up. Once you put that sticker on, said in 2 hours, you're going to have a heck of time getting that car.
But okay, Clyde.
Anyway, there is other options. Even if you go with this one, why should one? It said in the thing, it did have an asterisk, but in the thing, I think the sheriff's department garage will pull for them, which to me translates to Adam, so you can tell me if I'm right or wrong. It should be put out to bid or either on rotation for all the garages that want to participate and have the facilities. I mean, just jumping into this thing, it looks like to me, I look, and all of a sudden there it is on the agenda. And nothing, no real thought seems to have went in it. But if you're going to do it, I'm for the boot. County keeps money. And you ain't dragging people's car out of the yard. That looks like to me the way to go. But I'm against it, really.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. At this time, I have no public comments left, so we're going to close the public comment session. And I will open the public hearing on the school finance and bonds for Korean Technical Center. Do we have anybody that wants to talk about that?
Madam Chair, would you like me to give you a little
background? Yes, sir, you may.
I'll be glad to. What we're asking for tonight in the public hearing is looking at the financing option of using qualified school construction bonds for the construction of a $8.298 million Career Tech Center. This has been approved by the Board of Education as well as Board of Commissioners to move forward. Now we're in the process of looking at the financing. And the financing that we are recommending that we use, again, are the qualified school construction bonds. This is part of the stimulus package. And right now the interest rate will be anywhere between 0.5% and 1/2 of 1%. And as we've talked about in the past, debt service will be paid by lottery funds, and the $130,000 that we saved from our refinancing of the, I think there were the 06 bonds. And this will be over a 15-year time frame.
Okay. Anybody have any comments? If not, I will close that public hearing at this time. And the next thing on our agenda is Dr. Randy Bridges.
We need a motion.
I'm sorry. Do I hear a motion that we accept this school finance and bonds for Korean Technical Center?
I'll make a motion that we do.
I have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay. Sorry. All right. Now we go to Dr. Bridges.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Commission.
Good evening.
I, before getting into what's on the agenda, I did want to share just a little information with you, and I'll be quick so that we'll not hold up your meeting.
Yes, sir.
Oftentimes when we are having conversations with you, we don't often report on the return of your investment. And I wanted to give you just a quick overview of some things that happened within our school system last year. We got a little bit of this in the paper, but I want to be a little bit more specific. When you look at the indicators that we are measured most about, which is the test scores, I wanted to just share a few things with you as you look at this, and I'm going to talk from the little chart on the right side of the page. It's the schools making AYP in 08, 09, 22, in this past school year, 19, so there's a slight decrease there. I think you're well aware of the fact that No Child Left Behind and AYP is an all-or-none proposition. We did have seven schools that missed the AYP target by one subgroup. Schools making growth. This past school year, we had 33 of our 35 schools to make growth. 18 of those the previous year met expected growth. This past year was 16. And the reason for that slight decrease, if you look at the next line where it says high growth, we doubled. We really more than doubled from the 08, 09 year with 17 this past school year. Schools of Distinction also more than doubled from 4 to 9. Schools of Progress about the same. Schools receiving no recognition went from 4 down to 2. Priority schools increased, and that's an area of improvement for us, and went from having three low-performing schools year before last to having zero currently. In addition to that, our teacher retention rate continues to go down. The graduation rate, at least the projection from last school year, will go up. Our dropout rate last year went down, and we won't get that information until October or November. And I did want to call to your attention Cummings High School. If you remember 4 years ago, Judge Manning deemed it as a low-performing school and threatened some intervention from the state. During the 05-06 school year, the composite score was 51.6%. The school was reconstructed, and new administration, a lot of new teachers. In the first year of all that transition, the composite score went down to 43.4. But if you look at it now, 4 years later, Cummings High School, the composite score was 73.9. They met high growth, and they've been identified as a school of progress. So very pleased with things that are going on at Cummings High School. Not to always give you just the positive, but to also keep you aware of the fact that we are in a continuous improvement mode. And we need to get better at the academic performance of our kids. We need to increase our graduation rate and decrease our dropout rates, which still is above the state average. We have several achievement gaps as it relates to race, socioeconomic, language, and exceptionalities. And we're all fearful of school year 2011-2012, and that we don't know where, for us, about $5 million may come from if the stimulus money goes away. But I just wanted to share that just really quickly and now talk to you about the reason why I'm on your agenda. As of last Friday, we had to return $4.6 million to the state of North Carolina as our share of cuts from the state shortfall. We knew that. It was 3.4 year before last, and we knew that this year it would be 4.6, but that doesn't make it any easier to make those cuts. We did not lose any state paid positions. We had to do some shifting because of enrollment numbers, but we did not cut anybody or fire anybody or lay anybody off. We were able to do some things because of resignations and retirement. We potentially could have a $5 million shortfall, as I told you, for the 2011-2012 school year, and that's the reason why we've been very protective and tried to safeguard our designated and undesignated fund balances in preparation for that. We share with you every year a mandated portion of our budget, which basically deals with health insurance, retirement, and utility costs. And our projection for that issue is about $583,000. And we just backed the utility increase out of that. And what we're asking you tonight is to approve approximately $460,000 of lottery funds. General Assembly saw fit this year due to the economy to allow local school systems to use lottery funds to keep teachers working. And that $559,110 equivalent to about seven or eight teaching positions for us. So what we're asking you to do is to allow us to use lottery funds so that we don't have to cut our local budget in the mandated portion, which was not funded. Our lottery funds come to us quarterly, anywhere between $430,000 and $470,000. So, you know, by the end of this coming school year, the projection is for us to get about $1.7 million. And as you know, we've used that money over time to accumulate, and then we use it what is I think is intended for, which is to build buildings. We added on to Sylvan Elementary School, 4 classroom addition, and a 6 classroom addition to Beverly Jordan. So that's kind of been our way of handling those funds. So I don't know if this option will be on the table after this year, but they have provided for us this year, and we would like to ask for your approval and using these lottery funds so that we don't have to make additional cuts to our local budget.
Any questions for Dr. Bridges?
Will the teachers be in elective positions or elective, or will they be math teachers, or what type of teachers will it be?
We have, because of the way the state allows us to kind of flex the funding, there's a hodgepodge of teaching positions in there. We try to use our advantage by using the highest paid positions on the state budget and the lowest paid on the local budget. So it could be science, math, electives, it could be any of them.
Like, for instance, first year teachers and so forth.
Yes.
Yeah. Lower paid.
Any more questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion that we accept. Allow this.
I'll make a motion that we use the lottery funds.
A motion and second. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? Okay.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Bridges.
So did you. Okay. The next is Celebrating Families Week proclamation. Deanna Manning and, from the Family Justice Center and Tony Roper.
Hello.
Fine. How are y'all? Mr. Roper.
Good evening. How are you?
On behalf of the Strengthening Families Division of the United Way of Alamance County's Community Council, we're requesting that the County Commissioners proclaim September 26th through September 30th, Celebrating Families Week here in Alamance County. And I just want to take a second and read the proclamation. Whereas parents are the primary teachers of our nation's youth, and they are the first ones to educate them about the differences between right and wrong. Whereas families, by being proactive and involved in a child's life, pass along the traditions and principles that help make America a compassionate, decent, and hopeful society. Whereas the use of illegal drugs and the abuse of alcohol and nicotine constitute the greatest of threats to the well-being of America's children. Whereas surveys conducted by the National Center on Addiction and Substance Abuse at Columbia University have consistently found that the more often children and teenagers eat dinner with their families, the less likely they are to smoke, drink, and use illegal drugs. Whereas the correlation between family dinners and reduced risk for teen substance abuse are well documented. And whereas family dinners have long constituted a substantial pillar of family life in America, now therefore we're requesting that the Board of Commissioners from the County of Alamance does hereby proclaim the week of September 26th through September 30th as Celebrating Families Week and urges all citizens to recognize and participate in its observance. And Tony's just going to give you a rundown of the weekly activities.
And if you all remember, of course, we came before you all asking for a specific day, but the committee looked over the things that we did last year and thought that it would be appropriate to extend it so that we could get more things into the observance. When we look at September 26th, where we will start on a Sunday, we're looking at families worshiping and playing together. On Monday, we're looking at families eating together, and this is more or less eating out, supporting our local restaurants. On Tuesday, we're looking at families cooking together, and we're partnering with some entities in the community, such as grocery stores, and I won't name them at this point in time, but to come up with menus where families will get together and cook and do something to bring family unity. On Wednesday, September 28th, we're looking at families exploring the arts. And on Thursday, we're looking at families reading together. And as you look at the various activities that we're asking the community to participate in, it's all about building and strengthening the family.
Okay. Very positive. We appreciate y'all doing that.
Okay. At this time, I will. If you got any questions for Deanna or Ms. Wilford? If not, I'll entertain a motion that we accept this proclamation.
So moved.
Have a motion on the floor. I need a second.
Two.
All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. Yeah.
Next is Mr. York, if you will come forward, please. We're going to talk about tax matters, aren't we?
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the board. I'm here this evening to, first of all, present the annual tax settlement statement for tax year 2009. I believe each of you have a copy of the report in your packet, and we'll start by asking if you have any specific questions self-explanatory, I believe.
I'd like to hear from you, and then I have questions.
Okay. I guess the positive side of this is our tax collection rate is up this year. It was 95.7% last year. This year it's 96.68%. The total collection rate for real and personal property increased from 97.16 to 97.45. The total collection rate for motor vehicles increased from 85.79% to 87.56%. Looking at the history in the fiscal year, we can see in 2008, we collected 74%, excuse me, of the delinquent taxes. For 2007, 48%. For 2006, 37%. Fiscal year 2005, we collected 25%. In 2004, 20%. After that, the last 4 years, 9 to 6%, which indicates to me that we're probably wasting efforts trying to collect those older accounts. In the future, we will concentrate on accounts that are 5 years and less. I believe we're spending too much time trying to collect those old debts, and it's not paying off for us. Our total uncollected for 2009, which would include real and non-registered vehicle personal items and registered motor vehicles, is $2,097,428.52. We collected out of the general fund this year $61,084,131.05 out of a total levy of $63,181,559.57. We also started tracking our enforced collections this year. We started this in January of 2010. We have done 4,235 garnishments in the past 6 months. We referred 246 cases to legal for foreclosure. We've done 1,250 debt set off, which includes tax refunds and lotteries, and we have done rent attachments to 392 properties, which is basically all that we're legally permitted to do until we come to the second part of the meeting, which is levying and towing vehicles.
Okay. You can start questions.
I do appreciate, Mr. York, everything you've done, and I know you've worked hard. But with the information that came in the packet, I do have questions. Starting with what I have numbered as 7C. About three pages stapled together.
And that's the vehicle that he can't talk about.
Right, yeah.
You want to wait?
Yes, ma'am, if we could.
Two issues.
The second,
did you have something else?
So the second part of my presentation, we're required to only collect taxes for a 10-year period. The statutes only require us to collect for 10 years, so we need now to have your permission to write off the 2,000 uncollected taxes, a total of $84,000. Statutorily, we can't collect it after September the 1st.
Any questions on that? We need a motion on that.
I'll make that
one. A motion. Is your second?
Second.
Second. On Thursday, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
And I suppose thirdly, we want to talk about towing vehicles.
That's right.
And I understand there are several questions, so I'll open myself up for questions.
Could I ask one question?
Yes, sir.
I should have asked before we voted.
Sure.
I think my vote would change, but on the what we just charged off, what was the trend there? Did you see a trend at all as to what the basis of that, what the crux of it was, the 80,000, 84,000 that we couldn't collect?
Yes, sir. I think the problem there is that in the past there has not been enough attempt to collect the monies. In all honesty, I think that's been the problem. Obviously, there will always be some that can't be collected, but I don't think there's been enough effort in the past to collect the monies.
Was the trend the people still lived here, basically?
I couldn't speak to that. We don't have any way to trace that.
Were the tags frozen on all those?
No, sir. Most of we're on the cars, most of the tags are blocked, but there are numerous ways to get around the block, and I'd rather not discuss those ways because we have enough people that already know the system and know how to beat it, and I don't want to provide that information. But there are a number of ways to beat the block, and folks figure that out.
You have to tell them in private.
Yeah.
You have to explain that to me. I'm not going to do it, but he did explain it to me. What about on 2008, that $628,000 over there? Is that, we're still working on collecting that?
Yes, ma'am. We're still working on that. On the settlement report?
Yes, sir.
We're still working on everything down to 2001.
Okay.
September the 1st, we will charge off the 2000, which is the last debt there.
Okay.
But we'll continue to work on that. But the trends are, those older ones, we only collect 6 to 10% on the mm-hmm. older ones, so we're going to concentrate more on the newer debt.
We get more than that off that 2008, don't we?
Ma'am.
We hope we get more than 10%.
Oh, sure, absolutely. We plan on collecting at least 75 or 80% of
okay.
that remaining.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Good.
Madam Chair, we need a motion to receive the tax collector's annual settlement.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Where was that one?
That's item number one. I don't think you've
settlement of tax collector.
Yes.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion for the settlement of tax collector.
So moved.
Have a motion?
Second.
And I'm second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay.
The state law doesn't allow anybody to go after a person that owes taxes over 10 years.
Yes, right. The statute prevents us from going after any debts over 10 years old.
So what you're really saying is the sooner you get after them, the quicker and
yes,
the likelier to be getting that money.
Yes, sir. I having had a business myself, I don't understand waiting years to try to collect debts
right.
because your best chance is to collect it right away, as you know. And apparently that's not been done as well as it should have been done in the past. And we've moved past that, I think. And we're making good progress, in my opinion.
Well, the numbers are showing that.
Yes.
So that's good.
Do you want to talk about this or just start?
I think there are going to be a number of questions about it. The procedure is outlined. And this is not something that was done short-sightedly. About 2.5 months ago, I met with Mr. Albright, Sheriff Johnson, Mr. Britt, Mr. Holland, and our purchasing director, and we discussed this at length. It still needs to be refined somewhat. We talked about some of the things, like Mr. Shue mentioned booting. We checked with the Institute of Government on that. They advised to not do that. No one has ever done that. Their feeling is that if you damage the car, the county is going to be liable for that. On the other hand, if you have the car towed, the towing company will be liable for any damages that occur.
Okay, Ms. Allen.
Well, did you want to discuss this first, or you just want me to jump in?
Just jump right in.
Okay.
I've read it.
I have too. My first thought is, the Sheriff's Department contract, we don't know what that is.
Well, the Sheriff has 6 towing companies. This is information from Sheriff Johnson. They have 6 towing companies that they use on a rotational basis. Some of them have high-fenced insured areas to store cars. Some don't. If we tow cars, they would go to the ones that are insured and fenced and so forth.
Well, that was one of my concerns because I thought, well, I knew that we had a rotation system at one time.
Yes, ma'am. This is not a single contract.
And still do.
Yes, ma'am.
So I didn't want us to get away from that, that it should be open to any company that has towing.
Yes, ma'am. We talked
about
putting it out. And there are problems, of course, with security. All the towing companies don't have a secure area. Insurance concerns, damage concerns, photographing the car before it's towed, and that sort of thing. There are some concerns, and we'll work through all of that.
Okay. Step-by-step process. Okay. And then I'll go to the asterisk.
Okay.
Okay. number one, submit a 10-day demand for payment letter on legal letterhead to the vehicle owner.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, if this was me, I know what probably I would do. Is this going out by certified mail?
Probably so.
Yeah. Okay. Hold on just a second.
Ms. Vaughn, if you tell me what you'd do, that'll give me something to look out for what you'd
do. No, I don't know that I would. I'm not in that position. But what happens if the mail comes back to your office?
Well, obviously some of these people we will not be able to find, and we get tons of return mail every time we send bills out, so we will not be able to find all of them. But we'll make our best effort. The plan is for us to send them a 10-day demand letter and then turn it out to the Sheriff's Department, and the sheriff himself and two of his higher-ranking employees will be the ones who actually go to the taxpayers or the non-taxpayers' home to serve these papers, and they'll have 3 days then to pay. And then if they don't, then we'll go into the tow-in mode. And we do not want to tow anyone's vehicle. We do not want to be in the car business. But this is the last resort for us to collect this money. It's about $1.5 million outstanding car taxes now, and the county needs the revenue. We're a revenue department, and that's my job. That's what you hired me for, to collect as much of this money as we can. And we're sensitive to the economy. We know the economy's bad. We know people's out of work. But that's why we're starting with a $250 limit. To have a $250 car tax, you've got to have a $42,000 car. Now, if you've got a $42,000 car, you should be able to pay your taxes, in my opinion. We've had folks calling worried about taking grandma's car. We're not going to do that. We're not interested in any 87 Cavaliers or 85 Yugos. That's not going to happen. We're not trying to punish people, but there are about 150,000 registered cars in the county. From time to time, as many as 25% of those are delinquent. And right now, we have over 5,000 delinquent car tax bills for year 2009 that are over $10. And obviously, we're not interested in towing people with $10. But it's a huge, much, much larger than I realized. I didn't have any idea until we started putting this together how many people are delinquent on their cars.
Okay. And we'll go down here to collect that flat rate towing fee. Do we know what that flat rate towing fee is?
I believe Sheriff Johnson said that most of the companies charge about $75.
Okay. And what about storage fee per day?
I'm not sure. That's so things that we will...
No one's here from the Sheriff's Department.
That's things that we'd obviously check.
I think that would be something that we... Some of the details... We need to have. Let's go to the last sheet, execution against personal property for taxes. And I honestly do not believe that Mr. Albright has looked at this.
He wrote it.
You wrote it?
I did.
Oh, good. Sir.
I would have thought.
Before the date, the very last line, before the date specified by law, what's that?
What
is that the 72 hours? That's on the last page, on the very last line.
What part of that?
Last paragraph.
Okay.
Very last line, last six words. Ms. Dalbrook.
Yes.
This all comes to you, sir.
The issue date is... the sheriff signs this, hands it to the owner of the vehicle. If you pass the resolution to authorize the tax collector to execute against automobiles, it acts as if it's a judgment in district court. It's a judgment. So the sheriff is going and executing against a judgment. And he gives them a period of time, and I think we agreed in our procedure we're going to give them 72 hours.
Yes, sir.
Which is after this days. Is yeah. served by the sheriff. And the sheriff will fill this out. He'll complete this issued on the second day of August 2010, and 72 hours later, if it's not paid, the tow company comes and gets the car.
Okay, but if they if it's issued on Wednesday, and it sounds like I'm nitpicking, but I'm not, if it's issued on Wednesday, 72 hours will end up Saturday.
Well, it could be
fair.
It could be 3 or 4 days later, depending on the tow company's schedule. But within that 72-hour period, you can go in and pay your taxes, and it won't be towed.
Oh, absolutely. I understand that.
Ms. Vaughn, from what we understand from other counties, about 90% of the people do come in and pay.
In that 72-hour period.
Within yes, sir. And that's what we're after. Again, we don't want their cars.
Okay. Now, one thing I would suggest, Clyde, that would be on this would be the officer's return. So if Sheriff Johnson or Monty Holland or whoever does this, on this paper, I would think that you would need the officer's name and date.
Well, wouldn't it go down where the sheriff's name is?
Right.
Mr. Albright?
Yes. That's the date the sheriff receives it.
Who did this?
We could put a return on this.
Okay, yeah.
I drafted this based on what's in the statutes.
The sheriff has told me that he personally, along with Mr. Holland and Mr. Britt, will be the one to serve these. Those three highest ranking folks in the department will be the one to serve these papers.
So they would have that signature on there and the date.
Could you just put another line on it, Clyde?
It's the same process when you execute on a judgment. If the sheriff has a judgment in his hand and he comes and gets your car, only this gives him 72 hours to pay the judgment off before he actually comes and gets your car. We're trying to be kind to people and say, look, you got 3 days, pay your taxes, or we're going to come get it.
Yeah. Well, I was concerned about, you know, the 72 hours or 3 days, and suppose it was a long weekend like July 4th weekend. You know, those papers were served on Wednesday or Thursday, and, you know, how are you going to handle those 72 hours?
Would that be the hours the tax office is open?
Right. I think that'd be business days. I don't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I was going to ask. Would be Monday through Friday regular business days, or would it include weekends?
We can certainly change this to make that clear. That's
not a
problem.
Yeah, that would, you know, because I had the questions when I read it and tried to put myself in someone else's situation. Okay. This be a little clearer, sir?
We do not want to punish people. That is not what this is about.
I understand that.
We don't want the cars. We don't want to be hard on anybody. And we have repayment agreements. Folks can come in and make partial payments. And if you got your tax bill last week, I got mine and paid it this morning. Thank you. But if you got your tax bill, there's a thing on your tax bill that tells you that you can get partial payments. And there's actually an agreement on the back of your tax bill for you to sign an agreement to do partial payments.
Are they still coming out?
We'll make sure you get one.
Oh, thanks.
Well, the thing about this, though, they're delinquent in this. They know they were supposed to have already paid them.
Right.
I mean, you know, if they lost it or whatever, and that could be a good reason, and I understand.
Most of these people, I'll say, have had numerous bills already. This is not brand new. This is not going to be a shock to them.
I understand.
And 72 hours, to me, is a good. You better get down here and pay it, or we're coming to get your car. So I don't want to come get my car.
Even the little bit of media coverage we've had, people are already responding and coming in and paying. That's what we want.
That's the only purpose of it. Well, I got one question for you. On the back end of this thing, say you towed the car into the towing company, how many days do they have to do whatever if they don't, I mean, say nobody comes to claim that car?
Well, I think typically we're looking at 20 days. If they don't pay within 20 days, then we'll have a sale.
It'll be put on auction?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And that would be local auction?
Yes. And I would say, and I certainly won't ask the county to fund this now, but Durham County actually has each deputy's car has a reader on the dash, and every car they pull behind, they read that tag. And if that person is delinquent, the officer pulls them and gives them 24 hours to pay their taxes, or they go get the car of the tags. Now, I'm not asking for that, but I think that's a great idea. That's why they have a high collection rate.
Well, supposedly they shouldn't have gotten the tag to start with.
Right.
When did they start doing that? You pay your taxes, you get your tag.
3 years ago.
It's a good system if you can afford it.
Oh, yeah. Well, we don't want to afford that right now. Yeah. But I do appreciate everything you and your department has done. Y'all been magnificent. Done a great job. But I just had questions.
Okay, do we need to vote on this tonight?
We need to approve the resolution to authorize the collector.
Okay.
Yeah, I got a couple of questions.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I was sort of
go ahead.
What's the, you gave the top end example of 250 car would be worth, that's 1 year's worth of taxes, right?
Yes.
Okay. What's the lower end? I mean, what's the least you would go out on, and how many years would it have to cover?
Well, we're really not looking at a value of the car. We're looking more at the $250. If you had a $20,000 car and you hadn't paid for 2 years, that would get your bill up to about $250.
Okay. So if they owe $150, you're not going out?
No, sir. We've got, right now, I believe last count, we've got 1,300 people who owe over $250.
Okay. Is it all cars or is it boats involved?
Just cars. Just registered motor vehicles, yes, sir. And we certainly don't intend to tow 1,300 cars. Don't want to.
Wait for the auction.
But the numbers are kind of scary. They were to me because I had no idea we had that many people that were that far delinquent and that number of people who were delinquent.
So what you're saying is you're not going to tow anybody unless they owe at least $250 in taxes?
Yes, sir. Okay. That would be the starting basis. Depending on how successful it is, we could change that amount. And we may start with a higher amount. We won't start with anything lower than that, mm-hmm. but we may start with a higher amount. We'll look at the total number we have. And also folks who have a history of being delinquent. We have several folks that will come in and pay their taxes, go get their tags, and then stop payment on the check. In the future, we'll have those people arrested for false pretense. That's criminal. So we have people who write us checks on closed accounts. That's criminal in my mind. So
it is.
Although we don't really want to prosecute people, having been an ex-law enforcement person, I think we need to punish those who do break the law.
If you got one that's 250, say, for instance,
yes,
okay,
sir.
And they're game for the, the process, have you exhausted all your other efforts, garnishments? And
yes, sir.
So you would still try to garnish it before you went out?
Yes, sir, absolutely. You know, we've done, like say, 4,200 garnishments in the last 6 months. Mm-hmm. So we've done everything up to this point that we can that's legally permissible for us to do to collect this. The levy is the last resort. You know, this is something we don't want to do, but if you want us to collect the money, that's all we've got left. We've done everything we can, debt set off, attachments, bank attachments, rent attachments. We're kind of at the end of our rope. And once you've sent somebody a half dozen letters and they haven't responded and they don't have a bank account and you don't know where they work, you have to tow their vehicle, in my opinion.
Nobody's claiming they need extra staff to do this now, do they?
No, sir. No, sir. We're not asking for anything.
Sheriff's Department's
other than
not asking for anything.
No, we will not, definitely not ask for any more staff. I've got adequate staff. We'll not ask for any more staff this year or next year, or as long as I'm here, we won't ask for any more staff.
We've been keeping you a long time.
Can I play devil's advocate? Suppose a vehicle is outside of the county or state.
We'll definitely not try to.
You're not going to go to Mexico to pick one up, are you?
No, sir. Absolutely not.
Well, I don't know about that.
I believe that towing bill will be more than $75.
Yeah. Well, you know, we've already heard that it's possibly going to be in Orange County.
We'll go to Orange County. We'll make a special trip.
Yeah.
Now that we know where the car is.
That's it.
Any more questions? If not, do I hear a motion? We accept the resolution to authorize the tax.
A little short one. Do we need to make an amendment to that 72-hour anyhow, Clyde? Nice.
I can change the execution. That's the execution against property.
Yeah, I was going to say with amendment.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I was going to add that since we are changing some things.
We do need the order of collection in this resolution.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm good.
Okay. Do I hear motion we accept the resolution to authorize the tax collector on this county to direct executions against personal property with amendments?
I make that motion.
Okay, I have a motion. Okay. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Mr. York, you're doing a good job. Okay, next is Mr. Leonard.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, you have before you tonight a letter from the Alamance County Radio Club regarding the transfer of the surplus mobile command trailer to their organization. This surplus mobile command trailer is a 1982 model 32-foot travel trailer. It was purchased by the county around 1992 and converted into our mobile command center. As you know, last year we received a grant, and we worked very hard to prepare our new mobile command center now that we have, and we have that now in place and are utilizing it currently. As this letter states, the Alamance County Radio Club, through their public service efforts with the Amateur Radio Emergency Service Organization, known as ARES, have been a great asset to the citizens of Alamance County via their support of the county's emergency services. More specifically, the asset to the Emergency Management Department within Alamance County has functioned greatly with this team. Their main function is to provide communications in the event of a disaster where regular communications fail or inadequate. This organization is also responsible for providing manpower and communications for our damage assessment teams that are utilized after a large-scale incident. These functions are crucial within the county's emergency operation plan. Other agencies that benefit from the county Alamance County Radio Club are the Red Cross, the Alamance County Regional Medical Center, the Health Department, our local fire departments, our civil preparedness groups, and the National Weather Service, all of which are very crucial in emergency management activities within Alamance County. Due to the complexity of the equipment being utilized by this group, the addition of this surplus mobile command trailer would prove to be a valuable resource to this agency. Prior to offering this surplus mobile command trailer to the Alamance County Radio Club, I notified the local county fire departments and our local Alamance County Rescue Squad to see if they in fact needed this particular unit, all of which declined. It should also be noted that in the event, which is not likely, that the Alamance County Radio Club disbands for whatever reason, they have agreed to return this mobile command trailer back to us here with the county. So I come to you tonight to request the approval to start this process of transferring this mobile command trailer to the Alamance County Radio Club. With your approval, I'll meet with Clyde and County Finance to start this as soon as possible. At this time, I'll entertain any questions you may have. I have several members of the group here with me tonight, if you have any for them. I can speak from personal experience with this group, that they're a well-run organization. They train very continuously on the updated equipment that is out there. They've worked very closely with our department in the event of any type of emergency. We typically plan these, we start our preparation for any type of event that we know that is coming up, and they're quick to call and offer their services and work closely with us through anything that we may have, from a significant weather event to any type of a festival or whatever we are needing to utilize their services. So they're a great asset to the emergency management team. So by transferring this over to their use, it's almost like we're still getting the full benefit out of this trailer. It will be brought on site to any event that we need. All we have to do is make that request and they will have it there. They have a place to house this trailer. It has been inside ever since 1992 when a building was purchased to house this trailer, and they will continue to do so and maintain all the upkeep on it. So we look at it as a positive for emergency management services for the entire county.
Would you gentlemen stand up?
We appreciate what you
Thank
guys
you.
Do. Most definitely. It's a yeah. well-needed service.
Thank yes. you so much. Thank you. Any questions? One up here.
Is this all ham operators?
Yes, sir.
Let me ask you a question. You know, away from ham, and a couple of you might know what all took place years ago, but what's the minimum watt, maximum wattage on shortwave?
1,500 by 1,500.
Okay. Is it? Remember, there was somebody that was running so much power that they were toys at Radio Shack a block away were jumping off the shelf.
I'm serious. People couldn't watch TV.
I know
he
can talk about
it. You think he's right? Okay, all right. I'm just trying to figure out who you are. All right.
Your neighbor.
Yeah. Well, I thought it was 6 watts, and he was running 1,000 or something like that, or whatever. Well, you know, Howard Coble, he and I had some good conversations, but Howard Coble was supposed to co-sponsor legislation to where we could monitor it here at the local level. Remember we talked about that? I don't know if he ever did anything with that or not. But you don't seem to have that problem anymore much, do we, in the community?
Okay. Any questions for Mr. Leonard?
I think it's good.
I'll make the motion.
I have a motion already.
I'll second that.
And a second, and all in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. Which day?
On behalf of the club, I'm the club president. My name is Anthony Scandura, and I would like to say thank you on behalf of the club. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
You're welcome.
Okay. Next thing, we need to set a public hearing for the ROAP funding application. Mr. Martin?
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packet a memorandum from me regarding the ROAP funding. The county is scheduled to receive $342,404 in rural operating assistance funding for fiscal year 2010-2011. This is split between elderly and disabled transportation assistance, rural general public, the employment work first program, and then the rural general public fund. You have a listing here on the memorandum of the breakdown of the allocation that we're receiving from the state. The state actually has put a little bit more money into the employment work first funding this year, about $5,000, and actually took a little bit out of the EdTAP funding, maybe about $2,000. But there's a little more emphasis on work first right now and wheels to work, those sorts of programs. As part of the application process, we need to hold a public hearing, and staff recommends setting the public hearing for Monday, August the 16th at 7 p.m.
I'll make the motion.
No. I'll second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Okay, we will set a public hearing for August 16th at 7 p.m. Okay, the next is county a budget amendment for recreation and park.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm before you this evening with a request that you approve the additional $4,000 to the County Parks Department's budget. These are grant funds from the Burlington Alamance Convention and Visitors Bureau. $2,000 of these funds will be used to make improvements to the disc golf course at Cedar Rock Park, and the remaining $2,000 will be used by the department to print some additional Harbor Trail brochure. All these funds are coming from the CVB, which we do have Robert Cox with us this evening. He just happens to be here, and we're very excited about these funds. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Any questions? Thank you, Mr. Cox.
Thanks for being here.
Thanks for the move. Any questions? If not, I hear a motion that we accept this this budget amendment for Recreation and Parks Department.
Move.
So the motion and second, all in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Okay, then we go to County Manager Report.
Just wanted to give you a quick update on the construction out of Pleasant Grove. The construction has started on the gym. It's going very well. They've about blocked in the back area where we were going to put the additional storage area. Tim, Brian, and I last week went down to look at the modular unit that is going in. It's going very well. We're going back again tomorrow to look at hopefully the final version. So that we're really pleased at the way that has come out. So hopefully within the next 60 to 90 days, everything should be completed down at Pleasant Grove. So it'll be nice to get that project done and something that the community down there can be very proud of. But that's all I have to say.
I've been asked about that this weekend. I did tell the lady that it was a very nice looking building, and because I saw the outline of it. Mr. Burgess, you still have that, don't you? And if anybody wants to go look at it and see it, Mr. Burgess can show it to you.
So, I think it's something we'll be very pleased with. It'll have a pitch roof. Very, very impressive building, and the construction of what we saw will be a very quality building as well.
Yeah, it looks good. Okay. Anybody got to pull anything from the consent agenda? If not, do I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda?
Yes.
Motion and second, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay,
next we have
the Commissioner's comments.
I do.
Ms. Vaughn has the Commissioner's comments. Yes. No motion. No motion to the Commissioner's comments.
On July 30th, I went to the graduation ceremony for the Junior Police Academy. And I have been going for about the last 3 years, 4 years, since I've been here. We
The county was presented a plaque, Aiming, Believing, Striving, Succeeding Junior Police Academy 2010. Hope it goes up somewhere.
We'll see what we can do.
I do want to recognize the fact that I do understand that John Glenn, when he was chief in Burlington, started this program. There were a lot of young people that were involved. I was in awe at the ceremony that took place, but what these kids had to go through in order to graduate. It was like going through the military. The organizations I understood, and I hope I don't leave out anybody, Burlington Police Department, of course, Graham Police Department, and our own Alamance County Sheriff's Department. And by the way, he did get a plaque also. I'm very proud of what they do. Some of these kids are kind of little. You see that really little one down there in front. But they made it. They strived, they worked hard. It was a 4-week course that they took. And we're just really proud of these kids that they may have gone wrong at some point, but now they can identify with the police department. I think that the law enforcement has worked very well and very hard with them. There were a lot of businesses that sponsored this. If you can see this list, I know it's kind of tiny from where you are. And there are also people that have donated to make this program possible. So I say thank you, thank you, thank you to law enforcement that made this all possible. So thank you. Okay. Good morning.
Pass this
over. No, I'm seeing.
Yeah.
See if my son's in there.
No, he was one of the early ones.
Yeah, he got through.
Any more commissioners' comments?
That's a good looking group of people.
Fantastic.
I'd like to see it.
Do we have any announcements?
Oh, the food was served by Johnny Bakachosh at Western Steakhouse. So if y'all decide that you'll take this invitation next time, it was certainly worthwhile.
Okay. No announcements? We are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Green. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.